have flights during the afternoon. I think we need to start. And so it's with mixed feelings that we start this last session, because for one side this is the closing session, so this is the event is coming to the end. But on the other end, I'm happy to have Martha Whitehead with us today for the closing keynote of our conference. Martha Whitehead is the Vice President for the Harvard Librarian University, Librarian at Harvard University. And previously, to go to Harvard, Martha was Vice Provost and University Librarian from Queen's University in Canada. Martha is well known because she's been actively engaged on national and international activities and initiatives to advance digital scholarship, and has played a leading role in many of them, including the development of the Portage Research Data Management Network that was launched by called the Canadian Association of Research Libraries in 2015. She has also served as chair or president of many organizations and initiatives. And it's really also a privilege that she serves with me on the currently on the executive board of the Confederation of Open Access Repository. So Martha, it's with great pleasure that I give you the floor for the closing keynote.
Research, people who help people do research, and and we're trying to dive through various layers of enabling things like policy, services, and infrastructure to get at that data. I also wanted to just note this, because it came up a lot in the last few days, this question of competition versus collaboration. And that's sort of what I was referring to at the beginning, thinking about the value of the collaborative work that I do externally. So, you know, arriving at Harvard, I talked about this idea of the global knowledge commons, and my provost said, that sounds really good, but what's in it for Harvard, right? And that's always what we have to think about, is our own constituencies. And my belief is that really it is that collaboration that gives us a competitive advantage. So being able to both disseminate Harvard's research and access other research from around the world is really important for us to be able to operate at the local level. And it's what we do with it at the local level that makes us special. So I mentioned Peter. As you know, Peter is a great thinker in the open access movement. He's also responsible for our digital repository at Harvard. And I thought I would start just by reminding us all of why we do all of this, why we think about this. So I got a number of stories that we collect as people talk about the impact of open access for them. So I picked one from a professor in Portugal. I'm a professor of tax law at the University of Porto. To have access to specific and specialized papers about current and important tax matters is fundamental. So I feel very grateful to have the possibility of reading your papers and using them in my lessons and sharing them with my students. So we often talk about this being about research, but of course it's about open education as well. And then a faculty member in Pakistan. We the people in less privileged countries feel so fortunate that fabulous universities and institutions have shared their knowledge resources as open access sources. It's hoped that more and more knowledge will make them available free through the web for the common good of humanity, irrespective of race, color, religion, poor or rich. And then a student in Kenya, thanks for making some of these articles available to those of us who seek to make the world a better place. So I almost didn't pick the quote from Pakistan because I don't like to think in terms of less privileged countries and fabulous universities and institutions. For us, it's really about making sure that we have access to the knowledge that's produced around the world. And many of you have seen this picture. I know that the data may not be totally perfect, but I think that it makes the point that there's definitely a skew towards the Northern Hemisphere in terms of how we are accessing and sharing knowledge. So this is really related to those values of diversity and inclusion that I mentioned. And Paula did a nice job of introducing those terms. I'll just repeat it again. Diversity is when we're talking about having a wide range of voices and perspectives present and participating. When we talk about inclusivity, we're talking about community spaces, events, or solutions that are designed to be for people from a wide range of backgrounds. And then, of course, when we're talking about open, we're talking about removing any barriers to access, especially for the tools of production of scholarly content and the outputs of that work. How many of you have seen this cartoon before, this picture? A few of you have. Okay. I figured it would be popular, or at least the first two on the left-hand side. So this is that idea of talking about the difference in the meaning of the words equality and equity. Excuse me. So really, equity recognizes that there's this sense of systemic barriers and that different people will need different amounts of resources or support in order to succeed and overcome those barriers. So there's various versions of this picture. One of the reasons that people like these ones is that you'll notice there's three boxes on the left. There's still three boxes in the middle. They've just been distributed differently to give all those people watching the same perspective. The third one was added at one point to say, well, really, why is there even a fence there? You know, let's make it open. So that's more of a sort of sense of open access. But this group that's called the Story-Based Strategy Group said, really, we should leave a fourth box in this picture because everybody has their own version of what they'd like this to look like and has various critiques. For example, there's no women in this picture, or that why is the one without the fence is the third one? It should really be the first one because somebody built the fence. So this is the challenge that I'm putting to all of you today, is really to fill in that fourth box. When we think about diversity and inclusion in this global knowledge commons, the goal is that diversity. The goal is to be able to share knowledge from around the world with others around the world. And we think of that in terms of providing an inclusion of various authors, languages, publications, services, tools, infrastructure. But the key thing of that is that the goal is talking about earlier today and yesterday, and how to achieve open, sustainable infrastructure. So I don't actually have that picture yet. I'm hoping that all of you will help to draw what it looks like. But I wanted to give you a concrete example that I read recently from Angela Okun writing about decolonizing scholarly data and publishing infrastructures. She said, I've come to understand that working outside conventional structures requires additional commitment, time, labor, and social capital. For example, Abena Busia describes the challenges faced when working on the monumental Women Writing Africa project. Despite the women involved principally wanting to broadcast American women's voices throughout the continent, the project being hosted within the US-based feminist press distribution network meant it was more readily available to North America and European audiences. So, you know, there's a group that is trying to do the best in terms of helping another country make this available, but it wasn't specifically designed for that country in mind. So in order to redress this issue, the co-founders, together with the feminist press, had to purposefully pursue African regional partners, volume by volume, to publish and distribute the series on the continent. So I mentioned that because, actually, I was struck by the word ambassadors this morning as we heard about Plan S. Maybe I have a different meaning of the word, but to me, an ambassador is somebody who goes to another country to represent the country that they come from. And they're there for the people who are in their country, who are living there temporarily and might need help. Or they're, you know, there to say the good things that their own country is doing. I like to think instead it's a matter of all of us learning from each other. So when I'm engaged in initiatives with Africa, it's to understand what is it that's happening there, what value can they bring to my understanding of this landscape, and how do we work on things together. We have the same thing in Latin America, really far ahead of us in many ways in open access. Let's learn about what's been happening there. Okay, so my observations, back to this picture. So first of all, the idea of data. And in the library world, I came up with this thing of four different quadrants of data because four quadrants are important in everything we do. And the first is born analog. So I noticed actually that slide that's been showing at the keynotes has, I think, an image of a Da Vinci notebook maybe on the left-hand side. Is that what it is? Yeah, okay. So that's research data. It's definitely for the humanities. That's that born analog content that is in the upper left-hand side. The digitized analog content is something that research libraries have been spending a lot of time and resources on for a long time. And it's creating, it's things like that Da Vinci notebook, which by the way, I got to hold in my hand for the first time a couple of weeks ago in one of the Harvard libraries. Anyway, we're digitizing that content to make it more accessible. And in doing that, it actually creates new ways of doing research, of course. In the digital humanities, we can create all sorts of new scholarship. The lower left, I call that born digital analog. And the reason I left analog in there still, even though it's born digital content, is that idea that it sure looks a lot like that analog content. So we all talk about the 350-year-old model of the journal. You know, we created PDFs of those things and put them online. It looks basically the same. E-books still look and feel very similar to that analog content. And there's all sorts of challenges in that quadrant. We've heard a lot about transformative agreements in that quadrant, but really it doesn't feel to me as though it's taking full advantage of this digital landscape that we live in. So the fourth quadrant down here is the innovative digital. So that's where we're spending a lot of our thinking, a lot of our energy these days, thinking about research data as another form of this content that we want to preserve over time and make easily accessible. We're thinking about the whole open education landscape. We're thinking about whole new ways of delivering those things that were journals. And we talked a little bit this morning about the granularity of that content. So are there new things that we can think about as we think about articles? And I'll talk a little bit more about that as we go forward. So the thing that all these things have in common is that it's all about acquisition and production. So trying to make the most diverse collections that we have, disseminate materials so that that diversity is out there in the landscape. It's all about discovery, access, and delivery. And it's about preservation and making sure that we move that content forward over time. So I think that's the world that all of you have been talking about for the last few days. It's the what we're trying to do in open science as well as in research libraries. So moving on to journal articles, even though I was talking about that nice large set of data, I thought I wanted to spend a bit of time talking about journal articles. And they definitely are just the tip of the iceberg when we're thinking about the kind of data work that you're doing. But we end up talking about articles in this OA landscape for a few reasons. One is that OA, it seems as though it would be simpler in this landscape because we're dealing with articles who don't depend, or sorry, authors who don't depend on royalties. So they write articles to gain audience and impact, not money. I think the other reason we focus on this is the power game that we heard about yesterday in the panel first thing in the morning. So that idea of how scientists get credit, a lot of that relies on those journal articles. And also, of course, we've been concerned about the growing oligopoly of journal publishing and costs that support profit margins as high as 39%. So that's why it's worth spending some time, I think, talking about journal articles. Now, is Paula still here? I have to apologize for the pie chart. I think this is a good use of a pie chart, but you can tell me if I'm wrong. So this is with thanks to my colleague, Peter Suber, who has pointed out that in talking about open access, we should really be clear that we have some of the basic facts right. So as of today, the DOAJ lists a total of 13,628 peer-reviewed journals. And of those, 3,633 charge APCs, so that's the 26.6% in blue. 9,942 don't charge APCs, so that's the 72.9% in orange. The 53 who didn't tell us enough for us to know. So why are we focusing on the APC journals so much and not on the no-OA journals? Well, I think there's probably several reasons. One is that we hear most often about APCs, and so for institutions like mine, that seems an easy thing. Yeah, we could create a fund that would help us to pay APC charges. So it's just an easy thing to do. And of course, I think it's also because we recognize that in that sense of, as Neil was saying this morning, that large industry of people who are producing those articles, that's an area that is relying on APCs, and that's where those high impact factor journals sit. So I think that's partly what has skewed our attention into that APC world. But I just thought these numbers were interesting, just to validate that, yeah, we should actually be spending quite a lot of time thinking about this. So, moving on to the policy ring that is enabling access to all of this data. So, I mean, basically, if you set policies up intelligently, you provide a diversity of authors and perspectives, and if you set them up unintelligently, you lock some people out. So, to me, these policies break down into a couple of areas. I've highlighted the value systems of tenure and rankings because that's key. That's the thing that we have to address, and I think that was handled beautifully in the panel yesterday morning, so I won't dwell on that here. And then this whole range of data governance, some of which has been mentioned, others hasn't, but you know, the idea of freedom of information and privacy that we're always balancing, of course the focus on copyright. I think indigenous knowledge is an interesting aspect of this landscape now, as we think not just only about the authors and creators of works and the owners of those works, but also the subjects of those works. That's a whole other element that's moving into our copyright landscape now. And of course, data management plans and open access publications, which is what we're really here talking about. So, Plan S, and we spent a lot of time on Plan S this morning, so I won't belabor it too much, but I did have a couple of observations that I think weren't made this morning, so I'll mention those now. So first of all, Harvard Library and MIT did respond last September and noted that we are in support of Plan S for fostering a scholarly communications environment that advances the values of openness, equitable access, transparency, responsive stewardship, and flexible reuse. So we applauded it in many ways. We also recommended certain adjustments, which I think many other people recommended as well. We said that we would like Plan S to make better use of the global network of open access repositories, and we also felt there was just too great a focus on financially supporting publication fees, and recommended that financial support be provided for no-fee OA journals. So Neil was very reassuring, right, that yes, Plan S is definitely broader than that. But I did note that in the explanation about the revisions that came out in May, there was this emphasis that it's not just about publication fee model, but it's supporting a diversity of sustainability models. But it said that any lack of emphasis on those other models was a result of an assumption that these required less attention, as they are already a clearly successful element of the transition and aligned with Plan S. So clearly, from my perspective, they do need more attention, and I think that's what all of us in the room were thinking about this morning and wanting to see that happen. There is in Plan S, it does, of course, in Section 4, talk about supporting quality open access journals and platforms. It is there, but the question to me is, how do you actually make that a reality? Just like how do we make DORA a reality? So let's all spend some time working on that. So he knowledge available and accessible wherever it can have the greatest impact, as a good goal of helping solve humanity's challenges regardless of where that research was produced. And they share the belief that this common goal can be achieved through good, a variety of approaches. I did want to note, though, that La Referencia came out at the end of that month, May 31st, with this publication called Scholarly Communication and Open Access, Actions for Public Policy in Latin America. We have La Referencia colleagues here, I know, so they can answer any questions about this at the end. But essentially, I just did want to note that concern again, that we need to be really learning from that part of the world, because it is an area, of course, that has been very at the forefront of that approach to using publicly funded, non-commercial services to deliver open access. And I'm sure you're all aware of something that happened before Plan S, the Justio call for open science and Bibb University. And again, I'm channeling my colleague Peter because he has such an eloquent way of saying things. And I wanted to tell you what Peter wrote in terms of his reasons for supporting the Justio call. And of course, as you know, that the call aims to promote a scientific publishing open access model, fostering bibliodiversity, the term they use, and innovation without involving the exclusive transfer of journal subscription monies to ABC payments. So Peter's half dozen reasons for supporting this call were, first of all, one that hasn't actually been mentioned, I don't think, in the conversations I've been in, but is the call to move beyond PDFs. So that's necessary to bypass publisher locks and to facilitate reuse text mining, access by the visually impaired, and access in bandwidth-poor parts of the world. So that's something that we often overlook. It's recognition of no fee or no APC open access journals, their existence, their value, which we've talked about. It's call for redirecting funds now spent on subscription journals, we've talked about that. It's call to reform methods of research evaluation, we've talked about that. But this is the section that I think Peter is most eloquent. He said, I support its call for infrastructures that are proof against privatization. No matter how good proprietary and closed source platforms may initially be, they are subject to acquisition and harmful mutation beyond the control of the non-profit academic world. Even without acquisition, their commitment to OA is contingent on the market, and they carry a permanent risk of trapping rather than liberating knowledge. The research community cannot afford to entrust its research to platforms carrying the risk. And his final point is, I support what it terms bibliodiversity. While we must steer clear of closed source infrastructure subject to privatization and closure, we must also steer clear of platform monocultures subject to rigidity, stagnation, and breakage. Again, no matter how good a monoculture platform may initially be, in the long run, it cannot be better than the ecosystem. There's that scary word. How do we make sure the ecosystem works? An ecosystem of free and open source interoperable components compliant with open standards, offering robustness, modularity, flexibility, freedom to create better modules without writing the whole system, freedom to pick modules that best meet local needs, and freedom to scale up to meet local needs without first overcoming centralized constraints or unresponsive decision makers. I actually kind of blanched when I read unresponsive decision makers and hoped that wasn't me at Harvard. I don't think so. But I think that quite eloquently sums up what Peter admired about this call and what we hope to see in the landscape. So, moving on to the outer rings of this Global Knowledge Commons that really I hope are going to try and reflect what I've been talking about. So, here's where we really want to be in that fourth quadrant. We want to be truly leveraging digital opportunities. We want distributed, trusted networks. We want to avoid that centralized control, single points of failure, or the oligopolies that we see in the publishing industry. We want very easy processes for authors and researchers. This is our job, is to make these systems effective, not to say you need training to do this. Academic control comes up often in this landscape, and then we know that there's cost to this. We just want those costs to be reasonable and transparent, and for them to relate to the infrastructure, not to the data itself. So I'm just going to give you a couple of examples from my own past involvement in this idea of services and infrastructure, which speak to some of the challenges I wanted to leave you all with. So first of all, the Portage Research Data Management Network that was initiated by the Canadian Association of Research Libraries. This started with seed funding, basically, from a group of library directors who were concerned that we saw haves and have-nots across the country. So where you have a large university like the University of Toronto that had been able to invest in developing robust infrastructure, but you also had the smaller universities in Quebec that didn't have access to that, and wanted to say, well, how do we level this playing field? So with that seed funding, we created the small secretariat, and we focused on these two aspects of the network, a network of expertise, which was essentially using the secretariat to bring together people who contributed their in-kind time and efforts to this idea of sharing metadata expertise, help with preservation, and building that network of expertise and training programs. And then the second part was infrastructure platforms. And this is where it gets more challenging as you're thinking about how to build and sustain these things, as you all know. So we were working with a library consortia across the country, but also with other infrastructure partners like our high-performance computing and high-speed network to develop a variety of components for this research data management infrastructure. So a very simple, easy proof of concept was to take the DMP online and adjust that. Working with the DCC, we made a French version of that that was available to everybody in the country instead of everybody implementing their own. And then a more complicated one was a federated research data management repository system that provided repository for large-scale data that people might not otherwise have access to, but also knitted together regional and institutional repositories with a single discovery layer. So all that sounded really great as we started it as a pilot project, and it is going really well. But the challenges that I'd like to just mention about all this are, first of all, really a whole social aspect of this. Ensuring in that process that every institution really felt an ownership of it and felt the benefits at their own local level was really important to get even that seed funding to start with. And frankly, that was one of the more time-consuming and challenging parts of the work that I was doing in that. So it's very much the social aspect of things. Another social aspect was establishing shareholder governance as well as stakeholder governance. So the shareholders was, you know, the Carl directors who said that, yes, I'll put some money into this, and they wanted to know it was going to be well managed. But I think equally as important, or perhaps more important, were the stakeholders who were using that system. So finding a way to make sure that we had the researchers at the table. And then this idea of the financial sustainability, of course. We were able to move that seed funding into a larger project thanks to a federal government initiative. But now we have to think about how to move that on to sustainable operations. Those aren't technical issues, those are very much social. And then this morning, one of our panelists mentioned an overlay journal project. So I just thought I'd dive into a project that we were involved in Queens with Sir Timothy Gowers, and this was facilitated by CORE. And this was to develop a new overlay journal called Advances in Combinatorics. And essentially, it was just trying to explore this idea of collaborations between academic libraries and editorial boards that would come together. And the idea of leveraging open publications and archive was one of the objectives, just to see how we would do that. We essentially wanted to demonstrate that a high-quality journal can be run on a very small budget using existing tools. And we wanted to, in that sense of it being high-quality, we wanted to explore what the peer review process would look like as a service layer on top of this idea of next-generation repositories that the Confederation of Open Access Repositories has been working on. So I have never met Sir Timothy Gowers, but we had lots of Skype calls and great conversations, and I just love that he said this at the beginning of the project. You know, it's really simple. I hope that it will demonstrate once again, starting a serious new journal, it's not that hard, right? We can just do this. So I thought I'd just tell you a little bit about the model and how it wasn't that hard, but what we learned. So it was modeled on a previous overlay journal that Sir Timothy Gowers had started called the Screen Analysis. It uses archive as the repository, and so in this sense, the repository is not just the repository of journal articles that have been published or are going to be published, it's actually the source that you use in creating that journal. And it's the keeper of the articles longer term. So you start with the article in the repository, create the journal, you still have the article in the repository. We use Scholastica, which is a commercial product, an academic journal management software. We used it because he had used it before and he was comfortable with it and thought it worked well. His emphasis was that this is an ethical journal, so there's no charges for readers or authors. He was very clear about editors were doing this not just to lend their names, but they really were actively participating in this. This is part of their professional responsibility. And it did manage all the things that you would think of in a traditional journal infrastructure, the peer review, analytics tracking, integration with various other services. So the administrative task for the library, this is where my colleague Courtney Matthews comes in, were, first of all, just to get a service level agreement, just a little bit of back and forth about clarifying responsibilities and funding and what we would do in terms of in-kind staff support and the term of the commitment. Courtney took care of registering the DOI prefix, ISSN, custom domain, and making sure that things were listed in all the appropriate directories. And this is what's interesting to me. The cost of this for me, for my library, was really the equivalent of the cost of an article processing charge for a single article. So around, if you add up all those different costs for us, I'm not talking about the editorial team costs, but really for us to do this very lightweight hosting of a journal was around 2,000 euros. So it's very much a demonstration project. It was, I was curious, you know, what would this entail? The challenges, of course, that it left us with were, first of all, which journal software? My institution, we actually used OJS as our open journal software that we used to support faculty, so it was this different thing of using Scholastica. Was it the right thing to do? It was that sense of, too, that we are creating something that is a public good. It's relying on other public goods, or it's relying on a variety of different platforms, the Scholastica platform, but also the archive platform. So I think somebody may have mentioned that archive wasn't that expensive to run, but I do know people at Cornell, and I know there's costs involved, and you have to manage those costs from somewhere. So you're really subject to the archive funding models, governance, and their own priorities, and hoping that those continue. And then institutional priorities. Why did my university decide to support this particular journal? You know, I talked to my math department about it. They were thrilled. They said, yes, this is a good thing to do. But what are the guarantees that you can find that nice match? And then first of all, finally, of course, scaling up. You know, I'm giving you a very nice little example of a demonstration project, but as you know, scaling up into a distributed environment is a whole other question. And that's where PubFair comes in. So there are also people in the audience who are much more familiar with PubFair than I am, but essentially it builds on this whole idea that the Confederation of Open Access Repositories has been working on of the next generation repository. So at the bottom of the picture there, you see those variety of different repositories for the different kind of content that I showed at the beginning. Remember, we had the digitized analog content, we have articles, we have data. So from that, you can build an interoperability layer that lets you do all the things that you want to do with that content. And many different people can do that, in terms of the open peer review and other things. The stakeholders are scholarly societies, academic institutions, funders, individual researchers. You just have maximum flexibility with this system. You can create the traditional journal if you want. If you believe that a journal is important to build that sense of a scholarly community, you can still do that. If you want to create other sort of community channels, you can. You can create specific institutional channels. What's of interest to Harvard in particular? Or individual playlists, like librarians have always been recommending good resources. You can just create those playlists yourself. So that's the overall vision. This is only launched, I think, at the beginning of September. And if you want to go to the URL at the bottom, you can read this and offer your comments. I know we're very interested in getting feedback on it. Also wanted to just mention again, Amelika has been mentioned several times in this. It's an example of one kind of publishing platform that's very prominent, I think, in our thinking these days, because they have done nice commentary about how the approach in Latin America has been very different from what was initially proposed in Plan S and some of the things that we're still wondering about Plan S. So if you go, there's a, you can just Google this nice blog post, Amelika versus Plan S, same target, two different strategies to achieve open access. It just gives a kind of a nice history of the developments in Latin America. And then of course, we are seeing a bringing together of the thinking around these different platforms with the Global Alliance of Open Access Scholarly Communications Platforms. I understand they've started to have conversations about how we can work together in this landscape and really continue to bring things together. So we'll hear more from that group in the near future, I think. And I wanted to make sure, I think probably most of you by now are aware of this Invest in Open Infrastructure initiative. This is, I think, I would say it's in a fledgling state. It's just, it's early days. But to me it's important because it really captures some of the urgency that we're feeling to work together to support stable, sustainable, interoperable, and open infrastructure. It was really born out of a concern that more and more scholarly communication services are being bought by commercial interests. In fact, I think this started immediately after BPress was acquired. So that sense of wanting to work against that enclosure of the commons and think that there really must be a way that we could work on this financial sustainability. So as I say, it's at an early stage. It does relate to other issues. crowdsource a few services over the last few years. So this is thinking more broadly about envisioning an infrastructure that really will have this multiplicity of different services and systems that are interoperable, and how do we fund that? So early days, but I think we need to pay close attention to that. Okay, so those are sort of the observations of what I heard over the last few days and what I've seen myself working in this landscape. And I wanted to just pose a bunch of questions for you about how we can make all of this work. So first, so I have these several ideas on my mind that I will run through now, so I will pause and read them out loud to you. But first of all, as I said earlier, recognizing that infrastructure is social, I feel like this is where we need to spend a lot of our time and energy, and I wanted to thank my colleague Kaelin Boyd at Harvard for pointing out this article to me that I hadn't read before. I loved it because it's from 1996, when I was just getting involved in this network world, and just to go back and read about the thinking that was happening then, about, as the authors say, moving towards an ecology of infrastructure, design and access for large information spaces. So I pulled out this quote because I thought it was touching on a lot of what we're talking about here. An infrastructure occurs when the tension between local and global is resolved. And what it's really getting at is that idea of all of us who work in technology know that there's this tension between local, customized, and flexible on the one hand, and the need for standards and continuity on the other. And as we really move into this very distributed, decentralized technologies and global environment that is working across these geographical distances, it gets more complicated even. And of course, we have individuals who work in multiple contexts as well. So it's just to say that, yes, we can build the technology, but it's the actual social thinking about how we make sure we're meeting both those global and local needs that I think is really important. And there's some work that you may have seen, a group called Educopia, that, first of all, this community cultivation guide that I think is an interesting document because it talks about five core facets of a community's development. So we need to think about vision. That's an interesting comment about Plan S this morning. And what is the vision that we're trying to achieve? Communication tools and assessment, finances and HR, engagement and governance. They took that framework and applied it to this survey of the scholarly communications landscape where they were looking at scholarly communication resources, and it was not good news. That publication that came out earlier this year says that scholarly communication resources are operating within nonprofit and hosted environments report ongoing challenges in raising and sustaining appropriate levels of funding to enable them to build and maintain services over time. These SCRs need additional support if they are to be viable options for institutional use. So that's why I say I don't feel like we've got this figured out. I think we actually have to pay very close attention to these systems that are going to provide alternatives to the ABC model. In the Community Cultivation Guide, they also noted many potential tools and services wither, not due to shortfalls in demand or shortcomings in those products, but rather to a lack of attention to organization and community building. So my second thing that I want to leave as the challenge is let's start exploring. Well, I know we're starting, but let's continue really assiduously exploring the questions that need to be answered. So first top on my mind is, what does that financial support look like for the no-fee OA journals? How can promotion and tenure process that we heard about in very practical ways be changed? I've worked in several universities where I haven't quite yet seen how to do that, so I really look forward to working with others in the landscape to make that happen. How do we make open infrastructure sustainable, especially if it's that academic-led infrastructure? We're not all that good at really creating sustainable systems in a lot of ways in our organizations. How do we do that better? How do we work with other nonprofits to do it? And in that document I mentioned earlier, this mapping the scholarly communication landscape specifically sets out three priorities. First of all, they were trying to increase the understanding of that range of forms, functions, structures, models. And then they wanted to formally assess what the factors are that influence the sustainability and fit for purpose of those services. And then again, let's identify concrete tasks and activities that specific services can engage in to improve their sustainability over time. There's also this document you might not have seen yet coming out of the Association of College and Research Libraries in the United States, called Open and Equitable Scholarly Communications. It has many different research questions that it's posing to the community, and I just picked out this one because I think it's important for the conversations that we're having. What makes it desirable and possible for a wide range of institutions to commit to the creation and support of collectively owned infrastructure. It goes back to that question I posed in the context of Portage. What was in it for that the largest institution in the country that could actually possibly deliver services on their own? What was in it for them to be part of this larger collaborative network? And then how can we make sure that in doing that, in creating that larger network, issues of equity and voice are handled effectively? The third thing I think we can do is adopt good practice principles for open infrastructure. And this is a good first step in any endeavor. CORE and Spark put out this document that you can easily Google and find that lays out a number of different things we can do in terms of good governance, open standards, fair data collection, transparent pricing contracts, easy migration, success planning, and open content. And it's worth noting that they did this in reaction to that concern about services being purchased and enclosed. And as all of us in institutions are thinking about who we do want to work with, or in our collaborations to build open infrastructure, who do we want to work with, we can create principles like these. And these come from a variety of different sources, including Cameron Neal there was one of the provided lots of good thinking that led to this particular document. So for me, this is the kind of thing that funding agencies can use as they're thinking about bids for open infrastructure, or they can urge submissions from groups that would provide open infrastructure. It's good to work from principles like this. And then that idea of being inclusive. I think this is something I think we all struggle with. We want to be inclusive in industry. Of course, we acknowledge that there's a role in all of our organizations producing commercial products all the time. So how do we reconcile all these values with that sense of the power of those collaborations? So one example is this Mass Open Cloud. It's a project in Boston, a variety of different universities. It's hosted at Boston University. Harvard's one of the collaborators, MIT, Northeastern. And it's collaborating with industry and doing that in a very open way. So it's using open cloud exchange. And it is with that idea that we want this to be accessible very broadly. The other one I really like is Hindawi as an example. Again, it was Paul Peters, I think, contributed to this idea, the CEO, contributed to this idea of some principles that we should operate by. He said that in order to prevent private companies from owning and controlling this infrastructure, a radically open approach to its development is required, with four basic principles of openness: open source, open data, open integrations, and open contracts. And then finally, I'm not sure what to make of this word transformative. So for me, it's supporting truly transformative models. And I know I'm kind of beating this to death, and we've all talked about this, not just the flipping the journal. So let's flip the conversation. Let's not talk so much about APCs. Let's flip the conversation into this other kind of transformation. And I think that is where we're all trying to get to. But for me, we don't have a lot of practical steps in how we're getting there. So I was struck by the words of a colleague that many of you know, Jean-Claude Guédon, who writes a lot about open access. He was writing this on the 15th anniversary of Budapest. And it just ends, I think, on this note about thinking about why we're doing all this. So in no case should economic interests be allowed to interfere with the full potential of a free communicating system designed and destined to help humanity, the whole of humanity, so that means that whole global knowledge commons, to grow knowledge. Unleashing the full power of the distributed system of human intelligence remains the fundamental objective. So I wanted to leave you with that, and my own concluding thought that there's really no doubt that today's data realm is global, but our job is to make sure that it is diverse. We need to talk more about that, sustainable, and I'd really like to add the word thriving. I always feel like sustainable feels like a low bar. Let's have a thriving global knowledge base. So thank you very much.
And I think it will be almost an opening. We could start a new conference just picking up on the points that you raised. Maybe you try to avoid some of the inconvenient questions, putting them already, some of them on the on your screen, but I'm sure that there are certainly some questions. So I will open the floor for the for the audience to make
or ideas.
Or ideas, of course, or comments.
Thank you. This was truly amazing and inspiring. It could be a better ending of the conference. I have lots of questions I'll ask you. This first one, except for one small place in some big list, you did not mention the word fair. And so I'm wondering, I won't say whether it's good or not, but I'm wondering, what is your opinion of the role of fair in the much bigger global vision that you painted and we're all after of open science and open global commons and so on?
Yeah, thank you for that question. I think that's a case of where I thought that was a given, so I didn't mention it. Yeah, I admire and rely on those FAIR data principles. In my previous institution, we made sure to make mention of them. I find it's a nice way to engage researchers in the conversation and just talk about FAIR as a basic principle. We actually built them in my own previous institution into another concept of giving voice. So what I found, and maybe this is the case in every institution, is bringing in an external set of principles is very useful, but the community wants to build their own as well. So in the particular community that I was in, we came up with this thing of saying, let's give voice to research, and one of the elements of it was openness, and we included a link to the FAIR data principles in that. So voice stood for value, openness, inclusivity, collaboration, and engaged researchers. So we all have different, but yes, very important.
Kathleen.
Kathleen, are you going to talk about pub fair now?
No, I think I'd just be interested to know what your thoughts are about this, because I think one of the things we struggle with is the issue of branding, right? Like, we're trying to promote this diverse landscape, and yet the things that get attention are the big platforms. And so it's kind of human nature, I think. And so I wonder if you have any thoughts about how we can try to improve the visibility of a lot of these small and diverse things that we're doing and how important that is, and compete with the you know, the big branding that kind of the larger platforms.
Yeah. So I think one of the challenges that we have is that those large entities are good at branding, right? So we have a little project happening at Harvard right now where we're trying to do a little bit of thinking about values and vision. And of course, I've turned to a commercial entity that can help me facilitate an exercise that will end up with branding. So I think we have to acknowledge that there's some work to do bringing together people to talk about that. But the reason I mentioned that exercise is that in my own community, I don't know how many of you know Harvard, but it is huge, I'm learning. And there are many different schools, each with their own brand. So you probably all know the HBS, Harvard Business School, right? Like, it seems to sit out there with its own separate brand. So the challenge in my environment is to acknowledge that, and that that's a useful brand that exists. But how do we then create something for the whole? So the group that we've been talking about working on this is actually a group that works with restaurant chains, you know, to say, when you go into this restaurant, you're going to have your own experience here, but you're part of this broader entity. So I have thought that the groups, well, it's just been interesting to me to listen to reactions in the audience of people who say, yes, we have to do this, but not feeling necessarily that we figured out how to move along on that. But I have to say, again, coming from North America into the European context, I've been very impressed with what can happen under that EU umbrella, where you have people with funding able to come together and really move things forward. So I would think that this is a community that really has a way to do that, and also can reach out to the rest of the world to engage others with that as well. That's kind of a rambling answer, but it spurred a lot of different thoughts.
It was very good to listen to you, but I was wondering, what do you think is the main contribution from libraries to the open science community? What can the libraries give
started with the born analog, we moved into digitizing content, we moved into thinking about that born digital analog, and we're now in that quadrant of research data. So the work that I mentioned with Portal is very much a research library-led initiative of groups that were working directly with researchers, researchers who had, as part of their funding, were mandated to deposit their data. So within our libraries, we were using Dataverse as the repository for social sciences data. Our data librarians were the people who could advise people about planning for the management of your data over time, whether Dataverse was an appropriate repository, or did you know that you have this domain repository, or did you know that, of course, astrophysics, you've got your giant data repositories. And then contributing just to the management of that infrastructure as well, because we've been managing that kind of infrastructure for a very long time. So that's the ways that we've been contributing so far.
Any further question? Oh, yeah, yeah.
Second one. You mentioned that you came to Europe and you see how we work here. You talked about lots to learn from the Librarian in Latin America and everywhere. What do you think is the number one block to reach this global, how should I put it, for the globe to come together and do it, every part in its own way, but still to realize the vision, because science is vision, science is global, knowledge is global, but still there seems to be some blocks in that. What do you think is the biggest one?
It's hard to pick number one, but I thought you were going to use the word utopia, because there was that session that was facilitated on Monday about how do we reach this utopia, and I thought that was a really useful discussion that raised from all of you a lot of those factors. I think I was trying to represent those in the end. If I had to pick one as the key, well, you know, because I focused on diversity, I think I want to use the word colonialism a bit. If we could move away from the idea that you know, one group comes up with the answers and then presents those answers to the rest of the world, that would probably be a good thing. So that's something I haven't really emphasized, but that sense of really working together to truly learn what's needed and what's possible in all parts of the world would help with that. But fundamentally, I'm really interested in that investment in open infrastructure to understand how do you knit together an ecosystem that will really be sustainable in this landscape? So those are big challenges. It's a big challenge to leave everybody with. That's the ending. Thanks.
Cameron?
Thanks for a great talk. I was really struck at the end, the call for beyond sustainability, we need to thrive. Also brings to mind Brett Holbrook's notion about academic flourishing, need to create a flourishing environment. And then yet, we're still talking about blockers. We're framing the whole conversation about what we haven't yet done. We couldn't have really evolved like we used for a while. What can we learn from our successes? What can we learn?
Yeah, okay, I can end on a success. Well, again, you know, we all draw on our personal experience, but that Portage Data Management Network was a very interesting project, because what had happened initially was it had this very big mandate. There was federal funding available, and people were going to try and develop this big ask for this federal funding. And that initially failed because the people with different degrees of power didn't feel included enough, and basically, you know, sort of shut that down. So Kathleen and I were in a small working group talking about, well, let's just do something, right? And let's just try and make something happen. And so it was that finding the right people to get around the table. And one of them was Chuck Humphrey, who I don't know if anybody in the data landscape remembers Chuck. We always call him Grandpa Data. He was such a great figure. So it was getting, you know, starting from that kind of sense of who are the right people to get involved in this conversation, getting the right, the reason I mentioned Chuck is getting the right amount of ego at the table. Chuck was the kind of person who really knew a lot but could make everybody feel included. So he wasn't the sort of know-it-all, but he just could knit things together. And making sure that it was across sectors, it couldn't be the library sector saying, we can do this for you. It was, you know, we were quite humble about it, saying, here's this little piece, here's the piece that we can offer this landscape, and we collaborate with all of you to do this. So it took a lot of that, just sort of nurturing those initial conversations and then kind of broadening that out to convince people, you know, further and further out. So I come back to that sort of the success of those social interactions seems to be what led us to then be able to work with, later on, a financial initiative in the country that led to a multi-million dollar grant. So, but it was a big circle to get there. Yeah. So I'm optimistic.
If there are no any further questions, thank you very much, Martha.